Good evening, everyone. Today's lecture is on pseudophagic bullous keratopathy. And pseudophagic bullous keratopathy refers to the development of irreversible corneal edema that occurs after cataract surgery and intraocular lens implantation. It is characterized by corneal stromal edema with epithelial and subepithelial bullae. The corneal edema secondary to endothelial injury after intraocular surgery is a major cause of poor visual outcome and a leading indication for keratoplasty. In the core study done by Gupta et al., the prevalence of corneal blindness was found to be 0.12%, out of which 0.45% of people were unilaterally blind due to corneal disease. The primary disease responsible for corneal blindness in the study population was found to be pseudophagic bullous keratopathy, accounting for 46.2%. Since there is a high volume of cataract surgeries being done now in camps, there seems to be a shift in the burden from cataract blindness to corneal blindness in India. There's one more study done by Sharma et al. In 2019. The data was collected from 12 eye banks, and it was found that the second most common indication for transplantation was PBK, which was secondary to the first reason being keratitis. There was one more study done in South India by Mohammed et al., where pseudophagic corneal edema was found to be the leading indication of endothelial keratoplasty in South India.
Okay, so we'll just ask Maitri.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so you can tell me what is the WHO definition of blindness, corneal blindness. What is the, we are coming to a core topic where we are talking about a preventable cause of blindness. So all of you should know what is the meaning of WHO classification of blindness. You can choose somebody to answer or you can answer. I don't know anybody much because this webinar, I can't see anybody. You can choose any first year DNB student, please.
Meena, just see the names of the slides.
Yes, I can't see. I don't know this. Who this?
Doesn't matter. Call any name that is there.
Who is Aman Agarwal? Because he's A. His name is coming.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, according to WHO, blindness is visual acuity less than 3/60 in the best eye with the best possible correction.
Best corrected spectacle vision acuity. Very good. And so I'll take you one step further. What is economic blindness then?
Don't know, ma'am. This I don't know.
Yes. So you will read about what is social blindness and what is economical blindness. So the what you told was social 3/60 is equal to social blindness. So what was the? Oh. I'll choose somebody now. I will choose Komal Shah. Who's Miss? Dr. Komal Shah. Dr. Komal Shah. Okay. Dr. Pranav Sanjay Patil. They're not.
Good evening, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, unfortunately, I don't know the answer.
What was the question? Repeat the question.
The question was economic and social blindness, WHO definitions.
Okay, so anybody knows the definition of economic blindness? Can answer.
Less than 6/60, the best corrected visual acuity is economic blindness. Less than 3/60 is...
less than 6/60.
Dr. Sudhir?
Yeah.
Yeah, you can clarify for us, please.
Yeah, it's all there in the words itself. What is economical and what is social? Anything which a patient has vision where which he is not able to do is or earn his money, vision less than that is what is classified as economic blindness. Same thing happens if his vision is less than 3/60, or then he is not able to go and meet his friends, attend social functions, then it's called the social blindness. So these are few things which you need to know. So it's all pertain to the best eye. So the other eye may be NPL. Then the only eye which has the vision is what is taken into. It also, we need to look into the field of vision. You may have 6/6 vision, but the field of vision is less, then that also adds up to the blindness. Like example.
You're asking example, sir?
Advanced glaucoma, sir.
glaucoma. Yeah, next. One more.
Retinitis pigmentosa.
Yeah, so the field of vision has completely gone to a tubular vision. So how many degrees?
Less than 10 degrees.
30.
10 degrees.
So whenever you look at corneal blindness, so if the cause is pertaining to cornea, the blindness, whatever the definition of visual acuity or the field of vision, and then you also look into if it is coming from the cornea, then it is called a corneal blindness. So if a person has corneal vision is deteriorated in one eye, the other eye is good, you can't call them as a corneal blindness. Okay, so why this is very important? So if somebody has 6-6 vision in the other eye has, imagine he has pseudophakic bullous keratopathy and vision is 3/60, will you call them blind?
No, sir.
Yeah. So the main aim is when the vision in both eyes is affected and if it is due to cornea, which is the major component of the two eyes, and then you call it as a corneal blindness. One more question, if you go back to the definition, which is very important, can you go back to the definition slide?
Yes.
Yeah, you refer to it as pseudophakic bullous keratopathy of irreversible corneal edema. What is irreversible? When do you call irreversible? Is there any duration time period?
When the endothelial cell count goes to below the critical density value of 500 per.
No, he's asking duration of the edema. After which will you call it pseudophakic? Chronic edema, and what is the duration?
Usually, after we wait at least 8 months, the main duration is up to 8 months to 7 years.
3 months.
So you go back to your medicine. What is acute? What is chronic? What is relapsing?
6 weeks. More than 6 weeks.
Yeah. So anything which you are not able to reverse back in. Ideally, you keep it around 6 weeks to 3 months. Anything before that, it's not reversible. Then okay. It's irreversible. Correct. It's okay. You're gone from acute phase to chronic phase. Okay. Acute is because of you have induced iatrogenic edema. Okay.
Yes, sir.
It's acute, and it will start recovering. And if it is not able to recover, then it is becoming irreversible. So you need to look into all these definitions. So you go back and. I also looked at them. They have not defined what is the duration. Generally, you have to go back into your acute and chronic phases. When the disease is becoming from acute to chronic, then it's becoming, it's not able to recover back from that. Correct? Now, go ahead.
Coming to the basics of cornea, there are 6 layers, out of which most of the layers have a property. They have a...
So one more question. Yeah, we'll just take it a little forward. Can anybody tell what was the importance of this year in regards to blindness? Anybody? What is the year to this? What is this?
2020.
Within 2020.
So ironically, we are down with the pandemic, but otherwise you would all expect this question to be asked somewhere. So what was Vision 2020? What is the initiative that it was for? It's very relevant because we are all into community ophthalmology. Why I'm asking very basic questions is never forget community ophthalmology. This is where your love for the subject actually stems from. Not from being in a hi-fi institute and looking at fancy instruments that you will actually gain knowledge. It's from your community, the people. So you need to understand what was the bigger picture of all this. So anybody can see, or you will all have to write an essay on Vision 2020 and submit it to both to Dr. Sudhir and me. And the site for looking at this will be, there's a site called v2020.org. So look at this, you will see all the standard definitions and criteria and what was the entire plan of Vision 2020. All right?
Okay.
Continue. So, now I won't stop. Yeah.
most of the layers, they have a role in maintaining the transparency of the cornea. Like the epithelium has tight junctions, and the stroma, there is a lattice arrangement, there is a uniform arrangement of the collagen fibrils in a lattice, which is separated by a distance less than the wavelength of light. And there are presence of collagen crystallines, and the cornea is always in a relative dehydrated state. So all these help in maintaining the corneal transparency. Especially the endothelium has a very special role in maintaining the corneal transparency. It consists of a single layer of hexagonal cells with a diameter of 20 microns. There are numerous cytoplasmic organelles, especially the mitochondria and other organelles are present. And the most important, significant importance of the hexagonal shape is that it is the most energy efficient shape, and it leaves no gas to exposure to aqueous humor. And the endothelium also consists of an incomplete barrier with a preference to the diffusion of small molecules. It consists of apical macula occludens and the tight junctions and lateral gap junctions. It was found that the human cornea doesn't have the same amount of endothelial cell density all over, and it is more in the periphery compared to the central area. So the order of this one is that it is peripheral, followed by paracentral and then central. So the superior peripheral region of the corneal endothelium is found to have the highest endothelial cell density.
Yeah,
so the endothelial cell density is highest at birth. It is around 6,000 cells per millimeter square. And it then declines at an average rate of 0.6% per year in normal corneas. And the average cell density in a normal adult is around 2,500 to 2,700 cells. And usually these cells are not capable of undergoing mitosis in vivo. The various factors which contribute to this is that these cells are densely packed, so there is they prevent strong contact. They exhibit strong contact inhibition, and so there is an upregulation of cyclin-dependent kinase inhibitor, so which keeps the cells arrested in the G1 phase. There is also TGF beta, which is a negative growth factor. It has a role in preventing the mitosis of the endothelium. And also, as we age, there is a buildup of reactive oxygen species, which also prevents the endothelium undergoing mitosis.
So why are we talking about endothelium, the cell number, and its inability to undergo mitosis for just one reason is?
Because once they are lost, if it is lost due to trauma or other reasons, then there is no chance for regeneration.
So at all steps that you do cataract surgery, you will remember this one point, that you will give utmost care to the endothelium because it has no regenerative potential, unlike your epithelium. And generally like the epithelium, nothing else can regenerate. So this is one reason why you'll keep this in mind. All right. Any cornea fellow there can tell us what are the phases of loss of these endothelial cells in life? Nobody. So is there any cornea fellow in the class?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you please?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So what is the, my God, I have an audience. Okay. So what is the phase of loss of endothelial cells in life? And can you name who did the study of this endothelial cell loss and count in vivo and ex vivo?
Initially, during the first two decades, there is the steep loss from around 6,000 to it goes to the adult count of about 2,500 in the initial two decades only. And that it, then it steadily decreases with 0.6% 1 year per year. And after 60 years, it again starts to decline with a rapid more than 0.6% per year. I'm not sure about author of the study.
Adler says only up to 5 years there is a high rate of cell, and then there is an exponential loss of cells. Okay, it stabilizes only by 5 years. After 5 years, it comes to near adult cell density. So So there is a loss at 5 to 6 years. The rate of cell loss is higher at the earlier phase of life, not at the second decade. All right. Okay. Go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. So these cells are lost through age-related apoptosis, and the defect in the endothelium is compensated by active sliding and enlargement of the adjacent cells. Although the corneal endothelial barrier will be restored, the reduced cell density will eventually lead to an overall decreased pumping capacity with an accompanied increase in cell size and loss of hexagonal morphology. The critical density is found to be 500 cells per millimeter square, below which the endothelial decomposition occurs, as the passive leaking can no longer be compensated by the cell enlargement alone, leading to irreversible corneal edema.
Yeah, just stop there before. Go back to the previous slide. So you said, no, the next slide. Yeah, cells are lost through age-related apoptosis, and there is compensated by active sliding and enlargement of adjacent cells. So how do you measure this? How it is shown up in some of these investigations? You have various measures of endothelium, no?
In specular microscopy.
Someone else.
So polymegathism.
In specular microscopy, there is something called as coefficient of variation,
mm-hmm.
and percentage of the hexagonality.
Okay.
So a coefficient of variation is how different are different cells like that. So if there is any smaller cell or a basically it measures the polymegathism. If the cell is larger and it compares it with the other cells around, so it will give you how much there is variability in that. And the next one that we have is the it measures the pleomorphism, the percentage of hexagonality. So it should be around, normally it is around 60%. So if it's less than 50%, that means there is polymorphism.
So generally more than 60% of the endothelial cells are hexagonal. If it is less than 60%, then it's considered
abnormal. So what is it called?
Polymegathism.
Polymegathism is?
Polymorphism.
More difference in the sizes, shapes of the endothelial cells. That
polymegathism is increase in the size of endothelial cell to occupy the lost spaces of dead endothelial cell.
Yeah. And when it is multiple changes in the shape, it is called?
Polymorphism.
Pleomorphism.
These are some of the things which basic questions which you will get it in the exam. Okay. So you need to know what these are. So why do you need to look at hexagonality? Why do you need to look at coefficient of variation? So the variation also will tell you how the cells are distributed in the area where you are measuring. Okay. One more important thing is, how much area do you measure in the speculum microscope? I'm not sure you're having a slide on speculum microscopy specifically.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
No,
you don't have it.
No, sir. Investigations.
Investigations.
Okay. So fine. We'll come back to that later. Sorry. Because it's very important, since you have mentioned about the sliding, how you really measure this. Okay.
The maintenance of corneal hydration. The normal cornea maintains a state of 78% relative dehydration, otherwise called as corneal detergence, due to a complex interplay between many factors, which includes a leaky pump mechanism, stromal swelling pressure, intraocular pressure, tear evaporation, and the barrier function of the epithelium and endothelium. So as you can see in the endothelium, this is a schematic representation which shows that there is a metabolic pump, a sodium potassium ATPase pump, which prevents the inflow of fluid from the aqueous into the, which sends the fluid out to the aqueous. And there are a leaky barrier present, which allows the solutes to pass into the stroma. So that it is always a dynamic process where these two are always under action, and the amount of fluid is always kept at 78%. So the various changes seen in pseudophakic corneal edema are that normal basement membrane components like laminin 1, laminin 10, and type 4 collagen, which are adhesive in nature, are decreased. And anti-adhesive proteins like tenascin C, fibrillin 1, MMP2 are increased. And also the components, insulin like growth factor and TGF-beta2, which have a role in fibrosis and matrix deposition, are increased. And there are also studies to show that there are aquaporin channel abnormalities, decreased AQP1 and increased AQP3 and AQP4 found in these corneal edema eyes. So this is a schematic representation showing what happens in a normal eye and when there is a pseudophakic bullous, in contrast to what happens in a pseudophakic bullous keratopathy. There are a few things which we have to know. There are three pressures which we have to place a role. That is swelling pressure, imbibition pressure, and the intraocular pressure. The swelling pressure is nothing. It is the tendency of the stroma to swell due to interfibrillary proteoglycans and other proteins. And the imbibition pressure is a negative pressure excited by the glycosaminoglycans, by which the fluid is drawn into the cornea. So basically, intraocular pressure is equal to intraocular pressure minus swelling pressure. So basically, what happens is that in bullous keratopathy, when the endothelial cells are lost, there is also loss of these endothelial pumps. So there is a decreased functioning of these endothelial pumps, which leads to excess fluid being accumulated in the stroma. So when there is an excess of stroma, when there is excess of fluid in the stroma, then the stromal pressure becomes very less, after which the fluid gets, it can seep into the epithelium and the subepithelium space, leading to epithelial and subepithelial bullae.
So these were based on, when was these experiments done? Some many decades ago, okay? The imbibition pressure was an in vivo measure of the pressure in animals done by attaching some kind of manometer to the cornea. So it was a negative pressure, which is there in the cornea inherent in its capacity to prevent its swelling. So it's a negative pressure. But the way it's all in the way that it was calculated. Whereas the swelling pressure was measured by taking out the cornea from the animal. So it was an XYO measurement, and they put it up in a beaker of fluid, and it was the pressure equal to the pressure which was necessary to prevent its, again, to prevent its swelling. So the amount of pressure which it was necessary to prevent the swelling, whereas the positive pressure was put on the beaker, was measured. So one was based on in vivo measurement and the other was XYO. So the intraocular pressure is removed if it is measured in XYO, the imbibition pressure is actually equal to the swelling pressure. But the importance of in vivo measurements come because there is a intraocular pressure which is pushing the lamellar together, and at the same time there is a swelling pressure which is present. So in vivo, the imbibation pressure is always less than the swelling pressure. All right, so there are three important scenarios that you need to remember. One is the normal cornea, one is the endothelial decompensation, and one in which there is acute intraocular pressure. So what will be the difference in acute intraocular pressure in clinically, and what will be the clinical manifestation when there is endothelial dysfunction is what you should remember. So any cornea fellow can answer this question? No cornea fellow is there. Okay, so anybody else can answer? What will be the difference in high intraocular pressure and patient with endothelial dysfunction? There are two scenarios for endothelial dysfunction. One is Fuchs endothelial dystrophy and the other is post-cataract surgery, whether it is aphakic or pseudophakic. So what will be the clinical difference?
Ma'am, in intraocular
cases, there will be more bullae and epithelial changes. Ma'am, while in endothelial dysfunction, we will see more of stromal edema.
All right, and what happens to epithelium?
Epithelium, like subepithelial scarring in chronic cases can be seen.
But there can also be large bullae, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So what happens, where is the fluid accumulation in chronic stromal edema? in the whole of the stroma there is there is fluid. So what is the difference when regards to high intraocular pressure?
Ma'am, in high intraocular pressure, we'll see only epithelial changes, like epithelial bulle.
What is that word called? They are looking for a key word in that.
Gatte.
Microcystic
edema. Microcystic
edema. Microcystic edema.
I'm talking about high intraocular pressure, and if you go and utter gatte, they'll fail you there.
Sorry. Bye.
Yeah. Yeah. What is that clinical description for edema in high intraocular pressure?
Microcystic edema.
You all have to know this, microcystic corneal edema, because you're all into doing cataract surgery. So either you will have a diffuse corneal edema or you will have a focal area of microcystic edema, because there could be either a focal loss of endothelial cells or there could be retained viscoelastic and high intraocular pressure giving you a fine sheen. Okay, cornea fellow, somebody is there?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. So if there is high intraocular pressure post graft, why does that happen? There will be no microcystic edema.
Intraocular pressure post corneal graft, ma'am.
Yes. So what happens to the epithelium there?
The endothelial cell function of the newly sutured graft has maybe still not started functioning, so we won't be able to make out any corneal epithelial changes in patients where there is intraocular pressure increase.
What actually so happens is
the fluid.
Anybody else? So what happens in graft is the epithelium is dysfunctional, and only in functional epithelium you will see microcystic edema. What you will see in a graft is loss of epithelium, and so you will see a nice compact graft without any edema and without microcystic corneal edema, because many of the cells are already done with in the storage media. So if the pressure is high in a graft, you will not be able to make microcystic corneal edema. That's all I wanted to say. Yeah, go ahead.
And that is, you have to check for, actually, if the graft is very clear, that is the indication that you have to see whether the pressure is high. Because when your pressure is very high, the endothelium is still functioning there, okay? So ideally, we need to check with the pressure, the graft is very clear on the first 1 or 2 days. The pressure may be very high in these cases.
Go ahead.
Coming to the histopathology, there will be an attenuation and loss of endothelial cells with associated epithelial bulle and stromal edema. There will be thickening of the posterior collagenous layer of decimus membrane and decrease in stromal keratocytes. And there will be a lack of adhesive proteins in the epithelial basement membrane like fibronectin, laminin, and collagen type 4. And accumulation of anti-adhesive proteins such as tenascin C and thrombospondin 1, leading to the loss of contact of epithelial cells with each other and with the underlying subepithelial tissue, resulting in subepithelial bulle and fibrosis. So coming to the pre-op risk factors, the risk factors which have a very important role in post-op corneal edema are pre-existing endothelial dystrophy, pseudo exfoliation, glaucoma, heart cataract, chronic uveitis, and trauma to the corneal endothelium. It has been found that endothelial dystrophy can result in late onset corneal edema following surgery. And coming to pseudo exfoliation,
how can trauma be a pre-op risk factor?
So trauma. Prior to the surgery, they had any pre-existing trauma?
Very rare, no?
It's a very rare.
But I think they have to describe the trauma as general for all preventable blindness. Trauma is mentioned. So, yeah.
So
Basically, corneal ulcer or any full thickness penetrating injury, all those things will cause endothelial loss. Probably that. And why is age not there? Old age is also a risk factor.
Yes, ma'am. Age, ma'am, that is a physiological age.
Okay.
65 years. So, pseudo-exfoliation, it has been found that in studies that large clumps of typical pseudo-exfoliation material were found adhered to the corneal endothelium, so leading to endothelial decompensation. And also, glaucoma is found to play a role. Gagnon et al. Observed that the endothelial cell counts were inversely proportional to the intraocular pressure, and eyes receiving 3 or 4 glaucoma medications had lower cell counts than those receiving 1 to 2 medications. And the degree of cataract also found to play a role, with the denser nuclear cataracts causing more endothelial loss than early cataracts. And chronic uveitis seems to have play a role, since there is always an increased inflammation leading to decreased endothelial cell density. So systemic conditions like diabetes, renal insufficiency.
Again, and pseudo-exfoliation, remember one more thing, that even if you don't see in other eyes pseudo-exfoliation clinically, you should always assume that when you do a specular for that eye, the endothelial count will be lesser than a normal individual. So even if you don't see pseudo-exfoliation clinically in one eye and the patient has pseudo-exfoliation in the other eye, treat that eye as if the patient has clinical pseudo-exfoliation when you are operating on that patient.
Okay.
Because clinically you may not be seeing, but when you do certain investigations like specular and all, the endothelial count will be lesser. So gutte won't be visible in the initial phases. So that you should remember in pseudo-exfoliations.
Yeah. What is the one of the most important risk factor here? You mentioned all of them. What is the one most important risk factor?
Endothelial dystrophy.
No.
Glaucomas.
Glaucoma, fine. What else is there in glaucoma? I'll come back to the other important risk factor, which is very, very, very important. Before that, in glaucoma, what type of glaucomas and what are the other things which you look?
Chronic angle closure glaucoma.
Okay. Then you may also look for something else, some procedures done.
It's a presence of any valves or anti-glaucoma surgeries.
Yeah. Yeah, you have to look for YAG-PA. These are all the chronic angle, no? So there are studies which have shown YAG-PA also can cause cell loss. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. What is the other one most important thing which I am looking at here? The pre-op risk factors. Patient will have all the risk factors, but you missed. What is it? If you have not examined the patient properly, if you have missed all these things. No, the patient may have any, all of them also. And if you have missed it in your clinical exam, that is the most important risk factor, correct? Missing any of these.
Missing the findings.
Missing these findings is the most important thing. That is the most important cause of pseudophakic bullous keratopathy. You have a patient whom you are going posted for cataract surgery. You have not done your pre-op rounds properly and somebody has missed it. You have also missed it. On table, you can't diagnose any of them. And that is the reason for all the pseudophakic bullous keratopathy, adding up your risk factor from your surgery again. If you have identified them, you would have taken all precautions to prevent it, correct?
Yes, sir.
So that is the most important risk factor which we need to look at.
Okay. So the article from which you have quoted says one important sentence at the right at the beginning. What was it, Preeti? You mentioned it before. What is the most important pre-op risk factor, not from the patient side, from the operator side? What was that sentence?
Ma'am, patient in surgeon's inexperience.
Yes. So in the pre-operative risk factors, in pseudophakic or aphakic bullous keratopathy, you have to highlight the experience of the surgeon. All right?
Okay.
Go ahead.
Systemic conditions like diabetes, renal efficiency and COPD. And patients should be asked for history, medication history, especially since amantadine which was being used for Parkinson's disease, and topical carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, which are being used for glaucoma, can cause endothelial decompensation. And previous eye surgery must be asked for, like whether there is a history of peripheral iridectomy, trabeculectomy, intraocular lens implantation, and how the surgery went.
The surgery is fine. Yeah.
That's yeah. So, how, what is the status of the other eye? How, what kind of surgery was, if any surgery has been done in the other eye, and how was it eventful or not? Because
so this is the one reason why all of you should document intra-op complications very well. So the late complications like endothelial failure or any other complications, we will know only if you write proper notes. Your own notes 10 years down, how you operated. If you want to know what happens, you have to learn, you have to make it a point to document every step properly. Otherwise, you will never know why the patient developed all complications. Yeah. Go ahead.
Juan et al., he devised an endothelial risk matrix, which depended on whether suppose the patient had a fugues, and specular microscopy was done, and cell count, CV and hexagonality was taken into account, ultrasound pachymetry was done, and anterior chamber depth and the degree of cataract. Depending upon all these factors, the score was devised and score was given and calculated. And if the scores were taken as low risk, moderate risk, high risk, and very high risk, if patients come under low risk, a normal phaco with controlled fluidics can be done. In case of moderate risk, ultrasound sparing techniques like femtosecond laser and dispersive viscoelastics can be used. In case of high risk, it's better to go with extra ECC or SICS. And in case of very high risk patients, it is better to go for a triple procedure with DSEC or DMEC. So coming to intraoperative factors, in intraoperative factors also the main reason is patient, the surgeon inexperience, because it plays a very important role in post-op, in causing post-op corneal edema. And the other factors which plays a role is that surgical trauma, duration of the surgery, excessive ultrasound energy, high turbulence of the irrigating solution, and regurgitating of the nuclear fragments, IOL contact, phacoemulsifier tip trauma to the endothelium, decimates detachment, prolonged phacoemulsification time, and if there is a need for anterior vitrectomy and excessive irrigation and aspiration. So there was a study done by Bone et al. Which showed that there was no significant difference in the overall loss of endothelial cells at 1 year after either phaco or ECC. And high nucleus grade, greater infusion volume, type of IOL implanted, and large nucleus are independent predictors of endothelial cell loss. The mechanical contact with nuclear fragments is considered as a major cause of endothelial injury. And also difficult insertion of IOLs, especially ACIOL, is associated with a higher incidence of corneal edema. And it was also found that the cells adhered to the lens implants at the time of insertion. So if proper insertion was not done, there are chances that the endothelial cells can adhere to the lens implants, leading to endothelial cell damage and subsequent corneal edema. It was also found that Kanner et al. Did a study where he found that the patients with ECC and phaco who received IOL had a lower rate of corneal edema compared to aphakic ECC or phaco. And cataract surgery when accompanied by anterior vitrectomy was accompanied with a threefold increase in 4-year rate of corneal edema or transplantation compared with the cataract surgery alone. So coming to the type of IOLs,
Wait,
it was found that
one second,
Preeti,
just stop.
I want Dr. Shri Priya to take over all this.
Just a few points that I wanted to stress upon. You specifically mentioned the IOL, the cells get adherent to the IOL when you're inserting it. That's a very important point. And that's why all of you will be putting some viscoelastic on top of the intraocular lens before you insert it. This is applicable more to PMMA than to silicon lenses, because endothelial toxicity is much more with the PMMA. Second is all the risk-based classification of the technique that you will follow is also dependent on your skill. So it is not that ECC is better than phaco or phaco is better than ECC. If whatever technique works best in your hands is actually the most safe technique. And all the risk factors you mentioned in that, one important thing that is not mentioned is the plane of the phacoemulsification. If it's going to be above the back, then nothing applies. Okay. There will be endothelial trauma immaterial of not having any risk factor. And in glaucoma patients, it's not the, as Dr. Sudhir mentioned, the chronic raise in IOP itself causes endothelial loss. So you have to look at every glaucoma patient as a patient with poor endothelial count. And okay. if you have had recurrent attacks of angle closure disease, every time the IOP spikes, there is going to be gross loss of endothelial cells. So any eye which is in an angle closure eye on which you're doing a cataract surgery, even if it is primary angle closure or any classification, you have to be more careful that you maintain it in the back plane. And of course, the added on trauma induced by using carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. The lens nuclear fragments roaming around, that is what is called chatter. Okay, so there's no chattering. Is where there should not be any chattering when you're doing your cataract surgery. Thanks. Okay, carry on.
Thank you.
Yeah, again, one more important thing is for those who are in the learning phase and wanted to do phaco, and then so you have a right choice to choose based on your experience. So in case you find your cat during your learning curve of phaco, don't try to do all the hard cataracts, because that is the one of the important cause where you will have a lot of trauma because of the increased ultrasound time, phaco time and all that. So that is one. And even in SICS, again, make sure when the cataract is very dense, make sure you have a very good side cuts and incisions. Otherwise, if your side cuts or your inner lip is very small, you'll be struggling to get the lens out. And that itself can also cause damage, even though SICS is very good in these cases. But if you have not done a good tunnel, then you'll be having a tough time, and that will also cause more damage to the endothelium.
Okay, so Ankit is there?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so tell everybody, the juniors, what is the importance of viscoelastics in endothelial protection? How will you use it widely in either patients with endothelial dysfunction or without endothelial dysfunction? The two types of viscoelastics that you know.
Two main types are cohesive and dispersive viscoelastic. Cohesive viscoelastic are usually used to form the anterior chamber. They provide only the bulk, but dispersive viscoelastic, they coat the endothelium very well. So it has been described as soft shell technique, in which both of them are used in combination. So that is one of the good method to ensure that the anterior chamber is also kept firm during surgery to provide space for maneuvers, and and endothelium is also being coated with the dispersive viscoelastic.
So which one you'll inject first for soft shell?
First we will inject dispersive viscoelastic. And after that, we'll inject cohesive one.
What are the disadvantages of cohesive viscoelastic?
Cohesive viscoelastic are easy to remove. They don't coat the endothelium well. And dispersive viscoelastic, they are difficult to remove. So we need to do a thorough irrigation and aspiration to remove the dispersive viscoelastic. If we don't remove it thoroughly, then we might get a postoperative IOP spike.
So in addition to that, the cohesive viscoelastics are known as exothermic. So if you put a cohesive viscoelastic and put your phaco probe inside and start your phaco, it can actually transmit the heat to the wound, and it can cause a wound burn. So before starting the phaco, it's always wise to remove the cohesive viscoelastic or start your phaco energy at a lower energy, or not keep your wound very tight. If at all, you have to use the soft shell technique, because these are exothermic. All right? Okay. Go ahead.
ACIOLs and iris plane IOLs were found to have a higher incidence of endothelial post-op corneal edema. And the ACIOLs seem to play a role due to the improper sized, especially improperly sized ACIOLs have a role. where small lenses are really unstable and they move inside the cornea, causing an injury to the endothelium. And oversized lenses can erode the ciliary body, leading to UGH syndrome, and also it can lead to a chronic inflammation. And iris-supported or iris-fixated IOLs were associated with lens dislocation, iris chafing, iris atrophy, and delayed onset corneal edema. And intermittent touch between the cornea and the IOL also caused a delayed onset corneal edema.
Yeah, we already finished. Oh, this has come here.
Yes, ma'am. So other than that, BSS plus is found to have a protective role than BSS alone. And because the main thing is that because it contains bicarbonate and calcium, and these endothelial pumps are calcium dependent. So BSS plus seems to have a protective effect due to that. And for topical intracameral anesthesia, only 0.5 ml of 1% preservative free. So in any case of intracameral, if we are going to use anything intracameral, it is better to go with the preservative free solutions. Because benzalkonium chloride is found to cause endothelial toxicity.
So for all of us who are operating in institutes, we are very lucky that our seniors have protocols as to what has to be injected. So a caution when you leave the institute and go outside and some nurse or somebody gives you something to inject inside the eye, make sure that you are using something which is preservative free. Go ahead.
Coming to Descemet's membrane detachment, there are various factors which can lead to the detachment, as such age greater than 65 years, dense cataract, shallow anterior chamber. There were few people who were found to have, they have a predisposition to abnormal fibrillary stromal attachment to Descemet membrane, and in case of pre-existing endothelial disease. The other factors which can lead to DMD are complicated or repeated surgeries, inadvertent insertion of instruments between the corneal stroma and Descemet's membrane, which is very common in inexperienced surgeons, and anterior and shelved incisions, blunt blades, engaging the Descemet's membrane during intraocular lens implantation or with irrigation aspiration device, and unexpected injection of antibiotic saline or viscoelastic into the space between the deep stroma and the Descemet's membrane. And as I said, a surgeon's inexperience plays a very important role in causing intra-op DMD.
Okay, we'll stop here. Dr. Shripriya, you have to take over. Is Dr. Shripriya there? You're finished with DMD with this?
Ma'am, management will, yes ma'am, I'm finished. Management of DMD will come later.
So Dr.
Hila, you continue your class.
Okay. So it's very important to know there are some inherent risk factors. One is with age, and the other two important risk factors which we don't see is if the patient has gut ache. These patients can have ripping of the Descemet's membrane very easily because the Descemet's membrane is not very strongly adherent here. The other important risk factor is shallow anterior chamber. At least three reasons you will have: a narrow orbital fissure, you will have shallow anterior chamber, you will have guttate changes in which you can have the ripping up of it. The other things are all instrument based, that is, you're putting your AC maintainer in a wrong direction, you're having blunt instruments, and you're not, or you're poking the Descemet's membrane as you're entering the anterior chamber. These are all the or other causes. But inherent causes in the eye, you should know preoperatively so that you do not do anything to injure the Descemet's membrane. One is you do not inject viscoelastic into the Descemet's pre-Descemet's area. Second is you will not repeatedly enter the anterior chamber with your instruments, because even if you enter in the normal fashion, it can still rip off the endothelium from the superior direction. And once it starts from the superior direction, comes to the center of the cornea, it's very difficult for you to continue the surgery. You will have to stop, you will have to suture that site and go to another site and continue the surgery. Anything else, Dr. Shripriya?
Yeah, one more important thing which you need to look at is in the pre-op is dense arcus and dense crocodile chagrin. These are the patients who also have a high predisposing for DM detachments.
Okay. So coming to post-op causes of PBK, the most common causes, it could be toxic anterior segment syndrome. It is endothalamitis, herpetic endothelitis, retained lens material, and Brown-McLean syndrome. So toxic anterior segment syndrome is a sterile post-operative anterior segment inflammation, and it usually presents very early, within 12 to 48 hours of surgery. It is usually associated with minimal pain, diffuse limbus to limbus corneal edema, fibrinous AC reaction, iris atrophy, trabecular meshwork damage, but there won't be any evidence of vitritis. The typical offending agents are aseptic solutions used for pre-surgical preparation, intracameral anesthetics, irrigating solution, intraocular medications and preservatives, viscoelastics, and detergent residues on ophthalmic surgical instruments. And it is very important to differentiate them, TAS from endophthalmitis. You can see that in case of endophthalmitis, there will be vitreous exudates, there will be loss of red glow, and severe AC reaction with evidence of vitritis will be seen in endophthalmitis. And the next common cause of post-op corneal edema could be endothelitis, especially herpetic endothelitis is characterized by corneal edema, and there will be presence of KPs, which gives a clue to it. And there will be moderate anterior chamber inflammation, and may occasionally it can cause neovascularization also. There are different types of KPs. It can present with disciform or diffuse or linear and sectoral. And they always present with an elevated intraocular pressure, so which will give us a clue about it. And HSV endothelitis is common in individuals who are immunocompromised, and so a thorough history taking should be taken regarding prior history of herpes disease or any case of recurrent herpetic disease. Brown-McLean syndrome is not very common now. It was seen in olden days when it was especially seen in aphakic patients after ICCE. They were usually present with peripheral corneal edema, and where the central cornea is paired. And you can see brown-orange pigments present in the underlying epithelium.
So it's not very uncommon. I'm still seeing it because of a lot of lensectomies have taken place here. And now these patients are now presenting with typical Brown-McLean syndrome. So they seem to occur with any intraocular procedure and even after YAC capsulotomy. So can you tell some of the reasons of Brown-McLean syndrome, stated reasons? I mean, we are not very sure.
Direct contact and inflammation.
Inflammation, direct contact. Okay, yeah. So how is the edema in Brown-McLean syndrome?
It is specifically located in the peripheral cornea, ma'am, like near the limbal area.
And the central is relatively spare. It's like a tire. So we do see these patients even after lensectomy.
It may look like an arcus.
Yeah, but it is not. It's not in big institutes. It's not rare. That's what I want to say. Even there are huge numbers of lensectomy and cataract surgeries being done.
Okay.
Even with good techniques, they still seem to be occurring. Okay, go ahead.
So coming to clinical features, they usually present with disturbance in vision, and there is a difference in between stromal edema and epithelial edema. Stromal edema can cause only a mild decrease in vision, whereas epithelial edema can cause significant loss of vision. And they may present with pain due to ruptured corneal bullae. There could be photophobia, colored halos, and prolonged corneal edema can even lead to corneal ulceration, which often heals by scarring and neovascularization. So coming to intervention, a detail, suppose if the present patient...
Just a minute, Dr. Preeti. Yes. Can any of the first years tell me why a disturbance in the epithelial edema disturbs vision more than stromal edema? Any first year DNB?
You choose some name here from that.
Ma'am, I don't know the first years in Chennai.
Neither do I. You choose some name from that.
First years are babies. Ask for the second years.
Okay, ma'am. Second years.
Just joined ophthalmology.
Okay, any of the DNBs?
Yeah, that's better, I think.
Because it's the irregularity.
Epithelium more scattering of light occurs as compared to stromal edema.
Why?
More uneven distribution of edema in epithelial defect.
No.
Because of the
irregular surface of the eye.
Mihir?
Okay, anyways, I'll answer it. This epithelium is the first surface of the cornea. The change in any edema in the epithelium in the first layer will cause a greater change in the curvature of the anterior, because it is the anteriormost surface. The stromal edema will not affect that much. Epithelial edema will affect more.
Okay. And the difference in the refractive index is where the maximum refraction takes place. Air refractive index
the
is
interface,
one,
yeah.
And corneal interface is 1.37 or 33. So that's where the maximum refraction takes place. That's why any epithelial irregularity will cause a lot of difficulty, whereas endothelial edema or stromal edema will not cause. Similarly, endothelial scars will not cause that much of difficulty for the patient when compared to the same amount of epithelial scar.
Continue, please.
So, post-op, coming to when the patient presents with post-op corneal edema, detailed slit lamp examination of the operated eye should be done, looking for the location of edema, extent of edema, degree, and presence of there are any presence of DM folds and striate keratopathy. And there are a few things which can give us a clue regarding the what has caused the post-op edema. So localized edema can point to decimus membrane detachment, instrument touch, vitreous weak, or herpetic keratitis. In case of predominantly stromal edema, you can check for IOP. And limbus to limbus edema, you can it gives a clue to toxic anterior segment syndrome. And always, it's a we have to examine the fellow eye to rule out any pre-existing corneal endothelial disorder. It has to be done preoperatively, but if it has been missed, it is better to see at least post surgery.
Yeah, go ahead. This
image.
Yeah, just go back. What is striate SK? You see in all your post-ops, you write SK1, SK2+, SK3+. Somebody can define what is striate keratopathy?
So fold in the decimus membrane.
Mm-hmm. It's not folds.
It is a kind of stromal edema that appears as a networks and lines on a slit lamp biomicroscopy.
So it's basically striate crisscross or interface like thing happening in the stroma because of the edema of all the interfibrils have swollen up, correct? So, and you may not have the epithelial edema at this level, it's more of a stromal.
And if decimus membrane detachment is found, a careful evaluation should be done in a dark room with this high illumination and magnification to detect the presence of, to see how it is. It can be planar, that is just 1 to 2 mm separation from the corneal stroma, or non-planar with more extensive separation. And the location, the area of maximum separation, association with any other surgical wounds, tears, and loss of DM and fluid present in the interface should be noted for. The shape of the pupil can also give us an idea, like a peaked pupil can look, it could be due to vitreous, presence of vitreous. Atrophy of iris can be seen in herpetic etiology. An AC reaction, if there is a severe AC reaction, we can think of end of and TAS. And we should also look for any retained lens materials, KPs, IOL malposition or deposits on IOL. And if there is any presence of wound leaks and burns, and IOP measurement is mandatory, and posterior segment examination should be done. So coming to investigations,
pachymetry is... Yes. Why do you want to know all these things? How does it matter what the cause is?
Because depending on the management will depend on it.
Not only the management, the prognosis also, right?
Okay.
And if it's herpetic, it will recur in the graft also. So unless it is quiet for 6 months at least, you have cornea consultants to correct me.
No, correct.
You cannot do a PK, and the chances of recurrence in the PK are also very high. So okay. You will be guarded in your prognosis, and you have to tell all that to the patient even prior. And if you know it was an end-off or something, you're not going to advise surgery in that eye unless that's the only seeing eye of the patient. So etiology is very, very important. Okay?
So pachymetry can be done to find out the corneal thickness. And in a study done by Nida et al., it was found that she did a comparison of the central corneal thickness there was a comparison between four instruments, Pentagon, Visanti, Cirrus OCT, and ultrasound. And it showed that all the devices reliably measured the central corneal thickness when the thickness was around 650 microns. But in case of extreme corneal edema, Pentagon and ultrasound tachymetry were not reliable.
So simply you can just say that you have to do a detailed slit lamp evaluation. Any folds, prior folds present, you need to do a pachymetry. If the pachymetry falls beyond a certain level, and textbooks routinely say somewhere between 630 to 650 will be the cutoff, there you'll call it a thick cornea. If it is beyond 660, 650, you will ask for investigation and look for the health of the endothelium. So the routine population will fall within the Gaussian bell curve. Any extreme outliers on both the sides will not be measured properly. So all these instruments will measure only the normal population. Anybody beyond, you cannot accurately measure with any of these instruments. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, one second. Imagine that you are in a remote situation where you don't have access to pachymetry, you don't have access to specular microscopy. What is the first sign to know whether the patient has a endothelial dysfunction? On slit lamp, how will you identify it?
Guttes.
We look for guttes.
No, I'm saying there is an edema in the cornea. How will you identify? There is change in the corneal thickness. How will you identify on slit lamp examination?
Or you want to ask the history? Or you meant slit lamp?
Slit lamp findings. Simple. How do you identify?
Central and peripheral thickness.
Who is this?
Panesh.
Yeah. You need to look and compare the central thickness with the peripheral thickness. If the central thickness is same as peripheral thickness, so that's the importance of a slit examination. So you need to look at different locations. If your peripheral cornea is as the central cornea is as thick as peripheral cornea means, it's already is in the stage of there is an edema in the cornea. Okay, because the stromal edema is difficult to be measured. You won't get any folds and all things will happen in the late stages. And epithelial edema will happen much more after all the stroma is fallen, then only the epithelial edema will come.
Okay. So a specular microscopy should be done. In corneas with significant corneal edema, often the specular microscopy fails to give any reading. In such cases, the other eye specular microscopy can be checked. So coming to the critical cell density, the minimum critical density was found to be 5,000 cells per millimeter square. And the difference between two eyes, if it is over 280 cells per millimeter square, then it is found to be clinically significant. And the coefficient of aeration is usually it's around 0.22 to 0.31 is considered normal. And if the values are over 0.4, it is found to be clinically significant polymegathism. And usually the normal cornea has around 60% hexagonally shaped endothelial cells. Less than 50% is considered to have a clinically significant pleomorphism. Anterior segmentosis.
Yeah, go ahead first.
This is the single most important investigation to diagnose DMD if not seen clinically. It's also a reliable method to ascertain the corneal thickness in case of severe corneal edema. Other investigations are B-scan and ultrasound biomicroscopy. So coming to DMD management, the HELP algorithm was given by Ashok Kumar et al. And they found the HELP refers to the height, extent, and the length of the DMD was measured. And also the zone was seen, whether it is a central 5 mm or zone 2 is 5 mm to 8 mm and zone 3 is a peripheral 8 mm. And depending on these measurements, the management was done. So in case height and the length are very less than 100 microns, or if the length is less than 1 millimeter, if it is present in any, irrespective of any zone it is present, they did just medical management would suffice. But in case central involving DMD, it was a must that a surgical intervention should be done. in cases of height 100 to 300 micrometers and length 1 to 2 millimeter, depending upon the zone, the management was done. So if it was in the central area, so specifically what it means is that if it is in the central area, surgical intervention is a must. If it is in the periphery, we can go with medical management.
I told you to put some slides here, no pictures for this particular.
Yes, ma'am.
Otherwise, it's difficult for people to understand. No?
Ma'am,
the original author was Susan Jacob. This article, they have put it only for after cataract surgery for this. The original author is Dr. Susan.
Okay. So there was one more study done by Sharma et al., which also it was regarding the anterior segment OCT guided management algorithm for DMD after intraocular surgery. Here they found out whether it is planar or if it is non-planar, and also if the edges are scrolled or linear, and also depending on and they also found out the location of the DMD, and depending on that the management was done. So usually superior half with planar edges was managed with intracameral air. In case of superior half with scrolled edges, and in case of other inferior half or inferior half, it's any scrolled edges were managed with C3F8. And extensively involving DMD were also managed with the intracameral C3F8.
So the idea is you have air floats up. So all the superior half, even if it was non-planar or scrolled, it could have a tamponade effect. If you want a longer duration, you have to go in for isoexpansile 14% C3F8, which will stay in the eye for at least 3-4 days. The only problem with this is you may get pupillary glaucoma. So you have to make sure that after 10 minutes, you do not have a full fill, and it's only the eye should be filled only 2/3. Never fill with C3F8 100%. Okay, you're asking for trouble. You may even get a central retinal artery occlusion with the pressure rise with C3F8.
Okay. Yeah. So medical treatment for edema, topical hypertonic agents like sodium chloride 5% drops and 6% ointment can be used. Raised IOP has to be managed either with anti-glaucoma medications or surgeries. And we have to remember that carbonic anhydrase inhibitors and prostaglandin analogs must be avoided. And BCL extended wear can be used to decrease pain associated with the bullae. These lenses do not increase the visual acuity. It is just given for palliative care, that it is only for pain management.
So, why do you have so much pain in the thing? Do you continuously have pain in bullous keratopathy? Can you tell a little more about the pain in bullous keratopathy?
When the bullae ruptures, it can cause the nerves and nerve endings are irritated. It can cause an irritation of the nerve endings.
And in the chronic phase, they disappear because of?
Because of subepithelial fibrosis and...
Yes. So these are all for early stages of bullous keratopathy, that you give hypertonic agents and bandage contact lens. When it becomes chronic, none of these are useful. Yeah.
So anterior stromal puncture can also be done. It is done under a topical anesthetic under slit lamp. Multiple superficial punches are done, are applied directly to the bullae in the central cornea with a 26 or 30 gauge needle. This was found to give symptomatic relief in all patients actually who present with pain or discomfort. And collagen cross-linking has also been tried. It was found that collagen cross-linking induced stromal compaction and reduced bullae formation, and it improves corneal transparency, corneal thickness, and ocular pain after surgery. But it doesn't seem to have a long-lasting effect.
Yeah, basically, it's called the reactive oxygen species causes some kind of scarring there.
Yes. So coming to PTK, it has been found to provide symptomatic relief for recurrent corneal erosions in PBK, and deep PTK has been done always, and the mean ablation performed was of 206 micrometer thickness, and the corneal epithelium was removed, and the central optical zone is ablated with eczema laser, and ablation depth beyond the Bowman's layer probably promotes a stronger adhesion between the epithelium and the basement membrane. So it helps to reduce the risk of recurrent corneal erosions and epithelial bullae breakdown and pain. This should be restricted to only patients with poor vision.
Yeah, so this is not a common procedure. You can write it as a rare entity. So you have to answer in the exam either saying that you will give symptomatic relief, and for you will treat for symptomatic relief and for vision rehabilitation. And when the patient is capable of only getting the symptomatic relief when there's no vision potential, the other surgeries are to be mentioned, like your collagen cross-linking, or till the time you get waiting for tissue, you can do cross-linking and anterior stromal puncture and all the other surgery. So you'll have to devise a way to answer depending upon the particular patient that you have for the exam. Okay,
ma'am. So amniotic membrane transplantation also, it is found to be superior to conjunctival flap because it doesn't manifest any surgically induced limbal stem cell deficiency, and it gives a better cosmetic appearance. And also it's found to prolong the lifespan of the corneal and conjunctival progenitor cells. And the scarring also less comparatively in AMT.
So if you give fresh amniotic membrane, there are protease inhibitors in this fresh amniotic membrane. They reduce the enzymatic reaction in the cornea. But if it is an denatured amniotic membrane, it will act as a matrix over which fresh epithelium can grow and reduce the pain for the patient. The bulle can scar underneath this amniotic membrane. Go ahead.
The Gunderson's conjunctival flap the technique was done by Gunderson first. It was found by Gunderson and without the use of Tenon's capsule. The exclusion of Tenon's capsule increases the flap longevity, and the flap is thought to increase the local blood supply, promoting healing and replacing the damaged or defective corneal epithelium, which is also reserved for cases with poor visual function.
Preeti, I told you to put pictures for all this.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah,
ma'am. The other procedures which are obsolete are cauterization, annular keratotomy, and diamond bar polishing of basement membrane. So, coming to surgeries, the surgeries which are being done are PK, DSEC, and DMEC. Here in PK, we replace the entire host tissue with the donor corneal tissue, and in DSEC, we replace the endothelium and the decimus membrane along with the posterior stroma. And in case of DMEC, we replace just the decimus membrane and the endothelium. So coming to the timing of surgery, if there is no underlying etiology, we have to wait for a minimum period of 3 months before opting for keratoplasty. If the anterior chamber is very shallow and there is a dense stromal scar, we can go with penetrating keratoplasty. If the anterior chamber depth is reasonable, then even with a stromal haze, we can go with DSEC. DMEC requires a good visibility of anterior chamber. So no haze or minimal haze in the anterior stroma yields the best result in DMEC. So advantages of lamellar keratoplasty over PK was that there was no use of sutures. The spherical anterior corneal surface of the recipient is maintained, and there's less post-op astigmatism. It is a tectonically stable globe, easy rehabilitation and less frequent follow-ups, no epithelial stromal rejection, and late wound dehiscence was very rare. And repeated procedures were less traumatic because the rejected endothelial disc can be easily peeled off. So coming to future strategies, Kinoshita et al. This procedure was described by Kinoshita et al., where cultured corneal endothelial cells supplemented with a Rho kinase inhibitor was used to treat bullous keratopathy. Here, the diseased endothelium was removed and cultured cells supplemented with ROCK inhibitor were injected into the eye. And the patients were then placed in a prone position for 3 hours to allow the cells to adhere to the denude posterior surface. The results were seen after 24 week, where there was an increase in the central corneal endothelial cell density of more than 500 cells per millimeter square. And there was also a reduction in the corneal thickness to less than 630 microns. And there was also an improvement in best corrected visual acuity of 2 lines or more.
So this itself can be a question for you, I think, your ROCK inhibitors. It has its potential both in early open angle glaucoma and in endothelial cell disease. And in endothelial cell disease, it can be given as a post-operative medication along with a specific endothelial procedure known as DWEK or DSO, desmet stripping only keratoplast, desmet stripping only, where the peripheral endothelial cells help navigating it either by proliferating and moving over the basement membrane, or it can be injected like how the original authors of this apparent drug, this P27632, described by placing the patient on prone position, keeping the endothelial matrix in contact with the posterior stroma. So it has two implications. So read about this. It looks like a potential question to me out here.
Okay. Finally, I would like to thank MLY ma'am, NVN ma'am, Dr. PHR, Dr. MSI, and Dr. AH for helping me with the presentation. Thank you.
Meena, just one question. Do you still have all the anterior stromal puncture, and or do you still do?
Yes, it's I do quite regularly. It's a very useful technique. You can take a 26-gauge needle, bend it, and apply a lot of paracaine, or you soak a paracaine-soaked bud and keep it on that position. And almost 200 to 300 punctures should be done around 3 millimeter zone. So it causes microfibrosis by pushing in the epithelium below the basement membrane. So it stops the rupture of the bullae. So this is a good technique till you get a tissue to...
So you do it around the margins of the bullae, is it?
You do it directly at the site of the bullae and around and towards the periphery.
So the bullae will rupture in the process.
Yes. The important thing is, after doing this procedure, you don't give steroid because you want fibrosis to occur. You want wound modulation to occur. So you just give an antibiotic and a bandage contact lens and don't give any steroid, because steroid can reduce the fibrosis which you want it to occur.
Okay. I just want to add a couple of points. So when you
is a short case for the fellows, I'm supposed, you know, long case or a short case for the DNB students?
Ma'am, long case.
Okay. Long case.
And when she presented, you know, even cornea fellows are writing hypersulfite is drops and 6 is ointment.
Yes.
There are many prescriptions that come with hypersulfite as ointment. Okay. Examiners like to ask that. And another reason, symptom for PBK will be irritation and watering and photophobia. All those can be a part of PBK because of the irregularity of the surface. So rupture will cause an acute increase, but pain, watering and photophobia can be there as a part of the surface irregularity itself, because of, they'll always complain of chronic grittiness. And the other thing is, many times crosses come without fundus examination, blaming it on the bullous keratopathy. In these eyes, if the pupil will dilate, you should dilate the patient and do an indirect ophthalmoscope. Many times you'll be able to see the retina well, and you'll be able to guess the health of the disc. If you can see nice pink disc, this becomes very important when you have a long case, because if you say I cannot see the fundus, then the prognosis becomes question mark. Because if you find the disc is healthy, accordingly you can say that you'd like to do one of those lamellar keratoplasties or penetrating keratoplasties. Whereas if the disc is pale, you know that you're going to think of a conservative mode of therapy. And the other thing is, how do you decide whether it's partial thickness or full thickness graft, based on the extent of the stromal scarring and whether it's a full thickness scar. If full thickness scarring has occurred, then there is no point in doing partial thickness replacements. You'll have to consider more in favor of a penetrating keratoplasty. And suppose you have a patient with PBK, and what all will you specifically look for when you are evaluating the patient? Apart from what she told, iris atrophy and all can be a sign of a traumatic surgery or herpes involvement. Similarly, the cornea also, if you have a lot of deep vascularization, then think of more corneal disease like viral infection. That could have been the reason why the eye went into PBK. So you may have a nice pseudophakia. So if you see the iris pattern all healthy, pupil is still reacting inside, but you see a lot of vascularization and especially deep vessels, you keep viral infection in mind, because accordingly you'll have to put the patient on antiviral cover while you're operating. Correct?
Okay. Yes, madam.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah, the most. Yeah, I think the first line of management in exam, they, if the examiner asks, you'll always say the medical management and symptomatically treat the patient first. Then only you go for the second line, which is a surgical management. Any PK or any lamellar surgery, the patient has to wait for the tissues. So he has to be managed symptomatically. So patient comes severe pain and all that. First aim is to manage him symptomatically. Then for corrective procedures should be attempted. So don't ever tell the examiner, I'll do DSEC, DMEC or anything or PK as a first line of management. So first, any examiner asks you, I will symptomatically manage the patient, make him comfortable, and then evaluate him for all these things. As Shripriya was saying, look for a glaucoma, or if a patient has, say, if he has a chronic inflammation, the patient may have a chronic CME also, so which is again a cystoid macular edema. So you do all the good procedures, and the end of it, excellent DSEC or DMEC, but the patient has no good vision. So always manage the patient symptomatically, evaluate, and then is the next step is for a corrective procedure.
Okay, then thank you everyone. Thanks, it's been a long class. I'm sorry again, I think we overshot by 25 minutes. Thank you. Thank you, Sudhir, Shripriya. Thank you.